Hello all, my name is Ashutosh. I am a teacher by profession. My mission is to impart quality education for all. For that purpose, I am creating these videos. If you appreciate my work, then please do like my video and subscribe my channel so that I could get the motivation to prepare more videos.
Anyways, today in this third part of the multiple access techniques, we will going to discuss about code division multiple access and the comparative analysis among FDMA, TDMA and CDMA. So these are the outlines. We're going to start up with the introduction. Then we will going to discuss about spread spectrum multiple access techniques. So depending upon different types of spread spectrum modulation schemes, we will be having two variants of spread spectrum multiple access techniques. That is your frequency hopping multiple access techniques and your code division multiple access techniques, which is the example of your direct sequence spread spectrum systems. So after discussing both of them, we will going to discuss some of the advantages and disadvantages of your code division multiple access techniques, which will be followed by the applications of code division multiple access techniques. And finally, we will going to conclude via discussing the comparative analysis among FDMA, TDMA and CDMA. So in our last lecture, we have discussed about the contention-free protocols such as your TDMA and the hybrid techniques. We have also seen that the TDMA frame structure, along with the advantages, disadvantages and the application areas of TDMA and the hybrid techniques. We have also seen that the capacity of hybrid technique is much larger than the individual FDMA or TDMA. So now in this particular lecture, we will going to discuss another channelization mechanism, that is your CDMA. So now next multiple access technique is spread spectrum multiple access. So we had already discussed about various spread spectrum techniques and associated advantages and disadvantages that it will going to offer. Spread spectrum signals are highly secure. It is not possible to jam them easily. So these are certain advantages of your spread spectrum signals. So we had already discussed in greater details about your direct sequence spread spectrum systems and frequency hopping spread spectrum systems in greater detail. So here we will discussing about spread spectrum multiple access techniques. So all the basic functionalities and parameters are analogous to your spread spectrum systems. Since we are enhancing or increasing the bandwidth of individual users, so we could easily say that SSMA is not a bandwidth efficient scheme when it is used by the single users. Why we are saying that? Just because for transmission of single users data, we will be requiring much larger amount of bandwidth. So if many users can share the same spread spectrum bandwidth without interfering with one another, bandwidth efficiency will be improved, but will affect the capability to overcome jamming. So what do you mean by that? When this, at the same time, multiple users are exploiting or utilizing the same range of frequencies and they are in a state to communicate without going through interference with one another, the bandwidth efficiency would have been improved, just because with the limited range of frequencies, we are in a state to transport multiple users larger amount of data. But this manner will going to affect the capability to overcome jamming. So there are basically two types of techniques of spread spectrum multiple access. They are your frequency hop multiple access and second one is your direct sequence multiple access, which is also called as your DSMA. So direct sequence multiple access techniques would have also been called as your code division multiple access. Or we could also say that the code division multiple access is the example of your direct sequence multiple access. So now we're going to start up with your frequency hopping multiple access environment. So frequency hop multiple access is a digital multiple access technique. A wideband radio channel would have been used since we are dealing with your spread spectrum communication system. So obviously a wideband frequency channel would have been used. So the carrier frequency of each user are varied in a pseudo random fashion. If you recall that in your frequency hop spread spectrum system, your carrier signal frequency is not fixed. It is keep on changing randomly, and that random frequency selection would have been governed by the PN random sequence code. So frequency of multiple access allows multiple users to simultaneously occupy the same spectrum at the same time. So since multiple users are present in the same common environment and multiple users are transmitting simultaneously to their frequencies, but the subcarrier frequency they are exploiting to transmit their own information would have been dictated by the PN random sequence code. So in that essence, we could say that multiple users combinedly are exploiting the complete available spectrum. So the digital data of each user is broken into uniform size burst. So what will going to happen in this frequency hop multiple access environment is we will going to divide each user's data into uniform size burst. And then these bursts are transmitted over different narrowband channels, which was dictated by the PN code, or the carrier frequency would have been selected with the help of PN code. And at the receiver, a properly synchronized PN sequence is used to demodulate the signal. Just because without proper synchronization, it is not possible by the receiver to demodulate the signal, since it will not in a state to generate the same carrier frequency as it would have been used at the transmitting side. So now, what are different types of FHMA, that is your frequency hop multiple access? If you recall that while discussing your FHSS systems, we have described there are existing two variants of FHSS systems, that is your fast hopping frequency hop spread spectrum system and your slow hopping frequency hop spread spectrum system. So this fast hopping and slow hopping is dependent upon how frequently our subcarrier frequency will going to change. If subcarrier frequency is changing so fast that the transmission of symbol, your carrier frequency might get changed multiple times, then that type of frequency hopping would have been called as your fast frequency hopping. Whereas if the transition or the variation of subcarrier frequencies is much lower, then that would have been called as your low frequency hopping. So in fast frequency hopping, the rate of the change of the carrier frequency is greater than the symbol rate. This is what we have described. And in the low frequency hopping, which would also be called as your slow frequency hopping, multiple access, it has been defined as if the rate of the change of the carrier frequency is smaller than the symbol rate. So hopefully you have got the insight or idea about the fast and slow frequency hopping multiple access environment. So GSM and Bluetooth are the examples of your frequency hopping multiple access environment. So now we will going to discuss about CDMA. CDMA stands for code division multiple access. All users uses the same frequency, but each user has its own chipping sequence, or you could say its coded sequence, by which it will going to encode its information. So how encoding process will going to take place in CDMA system is encoded data will be equal to chipping sequence into original data. So what we will going to do that for encoding our signal is we are basically multiplying the original data with the chipping sequences. So chipping sequence is nothing but it's a kind of chip code, which is the combination of zeros and one. Then we will going to convert them into polar signaling schemes. That is, for one we are transmitting one, and for zero we are representing with your minus one, and that chipping sequence will get multiplied with the original data. So this is how encoding of CDMA signal will going to take place. For decoding, what we're going to do is the inner product of the encoded signal and the chipping sequence. So we will try to decode our encoded signal with the help of its own chipping sequence. So what we're going to do that, we will going to perform the inner product multiplication with the same chipping sequence. So this is how we will be able to decode our signal. So CDMA allows multiple users to coexist and transmit simultaneously with minimal interference, if and only if the codes are orthogonal to each other. So what is so peculiar about CDMA systems is it basically allowing multiple users to coexist and transmit simultaneously. So I mean, they are exploiting or using the same frequency band, they are also using the same timing slots, but then also interference will not going to affect them. Please keep in mind that here I'm saying that with minimal interference, or interference will not going to happen. So one might get the doubt that if in the same time, same medium, same frequency signals are present, then definitely they will going to interfere with each other. That is true. But the point is, in CDMA, we possess the technique that we can retrieve our information signal back from the interference. Or in that essence, we could also say that the interference effect will be minimal in CDMA. So when this will going to happen, if the codes with the help of which we are trying to transmit our signal, they are orthogonal to each other. So orthogonality is the special property which allows us to get the transmitted signal back from the interfered one. So each station transmits over the entire spectrum all the time, but are not garbled. So this is what we are talking about. Multiple simultaneous transmissions are separated using coding theory. So we will going to make a separate video about CDMA systems encoding as well as decoding process with the help of certain examples. But here, since we are discussing CDMA as a multiple access environment, so we will just going to take the overview how CDMA functions and what are the various features of CDMA systems. So this particular figure is showing the code division multiple access. Again, we will be considering the same example. We will be having these three axes, that is your frequency, code, and timing. Please keep in mind that here we haven't divided our frequency or time. All the users are using same time and same frequency, but the division we have formed in our coding axis. So we are actually have provided our distinguished users up to K1 to K6. We have providing them distinguished codes, and what is so peculiar about those codes is they are orthogonal to each other. So this is how our CDMA systems works. So depending upon the position of the transmitter and the receiver, there might be the case that at the receiver, the undesired user has the high power in comparison to the desired user. So what do you mean by that? If we recall the wireless multiple access environment, what we have say that there exists a base station and there are so many mobile users which are lying in the coverage of this base station. So obviously there might be the case that some of the users will be near to the base station and some of them are very far to the base station. So obviously this base station will going to get higher amount of power from this mobile station in comparison to this base station and vice versa. What do you mean by that? I mean this particular mobile user will getting much larger amount of signal from this base station in comparison to this mobile station. Or we could say that this mobile station will going to get the least power of the signal. On the other hand, since we are dealing with CDMA environment, so all the users will going to transmit their signal utilizing same frequency bands and same timings. So obviously when this particular mobile station will going to transmit any amount of signal, some of the power will also going to get by these particular users, these users. So that is why we are saying that depending upon the positions of the transmitter and the receiver, there might be the case that at the receiver, the undesired user has high power in comparison to the desired users. So in this particular scenario, if we want to distinguish about desired and undesired users' power, then we could say that if we are only focusing this user and this base station, so for this user, desired power is coming from this base station. But apart from that, the signal it is receiving from the base station, it is also receiving some of the signal power from these users also, which is undesired. So by default, the receiver will try to demodulate the signal with higher power, which will limit the transmission of the desired user. So receiver would have been designed in such a way that they will going to try to demodulate the signal with the higher power received signal strength. So here one thing is very important to understand that the effective transmission of one user will become the undesired signal for the other users. So the scenario that we have discussed, what will going to happen if for any receiver the desired signal strength is very low and the undesired signal strength is very high. Obviously the receiver will not be in a state to demodulate our signal properly. So this effect is called the near far problem in the CDMA. So what do you mean by near and far problem in the CDMA is those users who are lying just near about the base station will going to get high signal power reception in comparison to those users who are lying at the edge or far from the base station. So proper signal reception will going to become a bigger problem for those mobile users who are actually far from your base station. If these users are also receiving some of the signal power from undesired users, so this particular problem would have been called as your near far problem, and it can be controlled with the help of effective power control. So what do we are doing in our power control is we are actually restricting the transmission power of individual users depending upon their distances. So I mean base station will going to instruct those mobile users which are near to the base station, they should transmit at lower power so that it should not produce any sort of noise to the other users, or it will not going to increase the noise floor for the users which are far from the base station. So this is how we can control the near far problem. So the advantages of CDMA systems are, it is highly bandwidth efficient since code spaces is huge. So obviously it can transmit much larger amount of information. That is why we are calling them bandwidth efficient scheme, and it is dependent upon the number of codes available. Obviously we are talking about your orthogonal codes. So since large number of orthogonal codes are available, so with the help of those ports, highly bandwidth efficient transmission might be possible. So second important point about your CDMA systems is, it is almost impossible to jam since we are exploiting spread spectrum communication system. So anti-jamming is inherent in your spread spectrum communication systems. Then larger capacity and low power consumption. So power consumption in CDMA systems is quite low since we are transmitting noise-like signal, which will be having very lesser amount of power. And since large code spaces are available, so many number of people would have been used the common medium. So that is why we are saying that CDMA systems have large capacity. So the disadvantages of CDMA systems are more complex signal generations. Obviously, since we are exploiting spread spectrum communication systems, so the generation and reception, obviously it's quite complex since it is demanding high synchronization in PN sequence. They would have been implemented with the help of using spread spectrum system, which is also very complex. So now the applications of CDMA systems are, it is mainly used in wireless broadcast channels such as your cellular, satellite systems, etc. In present state of art, CDMA would have been widely accepted as your multiple access environment. So CDMA would have been used in interim standard 95, that is your CDMA mobile phone systems, WCDMA, CDMA 2000, etc. So these are some of the examples where CDMA would have been used. CDMA has merged with the GSM technology to have a high speed 4G or LTE internet services. So in the present state of art, whatever 4G systems we are using, they all are exploiting WCDMA systems as their radio interfaces and multiple access environment. So now this particular slide is showing the comparison between FDMA, TDMA and CDMA. So in our first column, we will be having several features. Then in the second column, we will be having your FDMA. Third is having TDMA and fourth is having your CDMA. So if we talk about the feature, high carrier frequency stability, obviously in FDMA, the major role is subband frequency selection. So obviously we will be demanding high carrier frequency stability. That is, we demand that users should in a state to generate their fixed carrier frequency. It will not get altered. So in FDMA, it is very necessary. Whereas in TDMA, it is not necessary just because we are dividing the time axis and the whole frequency band is being available to the individual user. So here it is not necessary. And so is the case for CDMA. Since we are allowing all the users to exploit the all of the frequency band available. So timing synchronization, obviously in FDMA, we don't need any sort of timing synchronization. Whereas in TDMA and CDMA, timing synchronization is required. Near far problem, obviously we had seen that it basically existed in your CDMA and it would have been controlled with the help of power control technique. Whereas in FDMA and TDMA, it does not exist. So variable transmission rate, whether it will going to support your variable transmission rate or not. So FDMA, it is quite difficult since we are providing fixed frequency sub channels to individual users. So utilizing those fixed frequency channels, it is not possible to support variable transmission rate. Whereas in TDMA and CDMA, it is possible. Fading mitigation. By fading mitigation, we mean that due to multipath propagation effect, the deterioration exists in the signal or not. So in FDMA, to reduce the fading effect, equalizer is not needed. Whereas in TDMA, equalizer may be needed. And in CDMA, with the help of rake receiver, we can perform the fading mitigation. So power monitoring in FDMA, it is difficult. Whereas in TDMA and CDMA, it is easy. Zone size, or we could say that the coverage region, in FDMA, we can have any cell size. Whereas in your TDMA, it could be of any cell size, but CDMA, if the cell size is large, it will be difficult to handle just because in large cell area, large number of users will be there and there might be the chances that in the coding space, we might not find that many number of orthogonal codes. So that is why we are saying that for large cell size, it is difficult. So this is all about your FDMA, TDMA and CDMA.
So hopefully you people get the insight about the code division, multiple access and its various features. And you have also understood about the comparative analysis among FDMA, TDMA and CDMA. In case of any doubt, you can ask me in the comment section and I will try to solve them as soon as possible.
These are the references. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.